सर माइक म्यूट लो। सर योर माइक इज ऑन म्यूट। सर मी माइक म्यूट लो ఉంది సర్।
సార్ మీ మైక్ మ్యూట్లో పెట్టుకున్నారు సార్। सर
सर माइक म्यूट।
माइक
सर माइक म्यूट लो ఉంది సర్। So your mic is on mute, sir.
Okay, thank you guys. You can hear me? Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, now audible. Yes.
Yes, sir.
Guys, can you hear me now? Please respond.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I can hear.
I can't hear you. I'm unable to hear you. Okay. If you can hear me, just okay. There is an option you can do thumbs up here in this more option. Yes, thank you for the response. Next, when we are talking about atomic radius and ionic radius, so here you didn't hear me, right? So this is the only new thing. Electronic configuration is valence electronic configuration ns2np5. Is only one electron is short of noble gas configuration, so that's why they try to attract electrons to get noble gas configuration and they become stable. So here atomic and ionic radius, halogens have smallest size. These halogens have smallest size. Why? From left to right in the periods, what happens? Size decreases, right? Halogens have smallest size. Okay, due to what? due to effective nuclear charge. Effective nuclear charge. So here, from top to bottom, generally, what happens? Though they are all small in size, but from top to bottom, from fluorine to chlorine, atomic radius, if you take, increases. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, like this, it increases. From top to bottom, what happens? It increases. Size increases. Okay. So next, ionization energies. Ionization energy. So what is ionization energy? To remove one electron, the amount of, to remove the valence shell electron, the amount of energy required. So here from top to bottom, what is happening? As size increases from left to right in seventh group, as the size increases, what happens? Ionization energy decreases. Okay. But ionization energy, compared to other groups, it is very high. Okay, because the very, you know, smallest sizes, ionic energies of these group elements are very high when compared to other group elements. Okay, next, electron affinity. Electron affinity. This is very frequently coming question. Electron affinities are different. What is electron affinity? Here, electron affinity is nothing but, suppose take an element and add one electron to it, it will become A minus, isn't it? During this case, some amount of energy releases. Okay, that energy is called electron affinity. And this is mostly negative values. Electron affinity values are mostly negative. So here, if you take these seventh group elements, electron affinity values, the electron affinity order of seventh group is fluorine is less than chlorine. Generally, this fluorine is expected to be highest electron affinity, but it is not. The reason I'll explain. Chlorine is only highest electron affinity element. Fluorine, chlorine, then bromine, then iodine. The reason here, fluorine resists the addition of electron. Reason, due to small size and 2p orbital, okay, strong inter-electronic repulsions arises when you are trying to add electron to fluorine. So that's what chlorine is having highest electron affinity. I also explained this in fifth group. Okay, fifth group also. Nitrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus. So phosphorus only is having highest electron affinities. Next one. Next we'll talk about electronegativity. What happens to the electronegativity from top to bottom in seventh group elements? Electronegativity decreases, isn't it? Anyway, when compared to other group elements, if you move from left to right in periods, what happens? Electronegativity increases only. But the last group, seventh group, we are talking about. Seventh group, when compared from left to right, as electronegativity increases, seventh A group will have high electronegativity values. High electronegativity values. Okay. But if you go from top to bottom, electronegativity values, what happens? Electronegative values decreases. So highest electronegativity is for fluorine, then chlorine, then bromine, then iodine. So this is electronegativity values. And you know that fluorine is the highest electronegative element in the periodic table. This is a highest electronegativity value, and the fluorine is the first top electronegative element. Its value is 4.0. Electronegativity value is 4.0. So this is basic introduction about seventh group elements. Next, we'll move to its physical properties. So I'm writing here physical properties, how they exist. Physical properties. Okay, physical properties. Here, if you observe their physical properties, fluorine and chlorine are gaseous and they exist as diatomic. Always two atoms combined, diatomic. Okay, and bromine is a liquid and iodine is a solid. Okay, fluorine is a fluorine, chlorine are gaseous, bromine is liquid and iodine is solid. Okay, is it clear? Next, their melting and boiling points. Melting and boiling points. So their melting and boiling points from top to bottom increases due to size increases. Fluorine, chlorine, bromine and iodine. And if you talk about their color properties, okay, color property, they all almost this all you know, seventh group elements, all are colored compounds only, all colored, all are colored. So here fluorine is having yellow color. Fluorine is a gas, it is having yellow color, and the chlorine is greenish yellow. You don't need to remember these colors, okay, just for the, you know, notes purpose only I am giving this. Okay, they don't ask what is bromine color, what is iodine color, like that. Okay, so it is having violet color. Now if you talk about their solubility in water, solubility in water, fluorine and chlorine, they react with water happily, okay, but bromine and iodine, they are sparingly soluble in water, sparingly soluble. That means they are slightly soluble in water, okay, but they are fully soluble in, but they are fully soluble in compounds like chloroform, okay, CaCl3, carbon disulfide, carbon tetrachloride. In this type of solvents, this bromine and iodine undergo full solubility, okay, but they are sparingly soluble in water. Next we'll talk about bond dissociation energy. This is very important. This is also previous question. Bond dissociation energy. Sometimes they also called as bond dissociation enthalpy. Both are same. It is indicated by delta H. Okay. So in this bond dissociation enthalpy, so chlorine-chlorine bond dissociation, this bond you have to break. Then bromine-bromine. Then comes your fluorine-iodine. Normally, fluorine is more electronegative, so it will have more attractions. So bond dissociation energy will be maximum. You think like that. But the reason here from top to bottom, normally bond dissociation energies are decreasing, but fluorine is abnormally low. The reason for this is in the fluorine, okay, due to the small size and maximum electron density on the fluorines, the inter-electronic repulsion takes place. Inter-electronic repulsions. So due to this inter-electronic repulsions, what happens? So their strength, normally this strength, FF bond strength decreases. FF bond strength, normally they are repelling each other. So this bond strength decreases So results in what happens? Bond dissociation energy is less worth. Okay, so that is reason. So yeah, what is your order of bond dissociation energy? Chlorine is the highest bond dissociation energy. Then bromine, fluorine, and iodine. So this is about bond dissociation energy. Now we'll move to some chemical properties. Chemical properties of halogens. Okay, chemical properties. Let's see. Chemical properties. So here, the chemical properties, before going into discussion of this, we'll talk about their oxidation state. It is a part of chemical properties, suppose. What type of oxidation states they will show. Normally, there is only one electron is less of noble gas configuration. So they all show, okay? They all show minus one common oxidation state. Minus one is a common oxidation state for all the group elements. Okay, so minus one is a common oxidation state of the seventh group elements. Like what? F chloride, fluoride, bromide, and iodine, like this. Okay, minus one is exhibited by all the group elements. But apart from this, your chlorine, bromine, iodine also exhibits plus 1, plus 3, plus 5, plus 7 oxidation states. So how they will exhibit these different oxidation states, that we'll see now. Okay, what is the configuration of that seventh group elements? NS2, NP, 5, isn't it? So 2 electrons in NS and 5 electrons here. So NS, next time writing NP5. So this is NS, this is NP. Here 2 electrons, here 5. So if you look at this, if you observe this, this one unpaired electron is present. So one unpaired electron present. So due to this one unpaired electron, it will show minus one. That means either it can accept the electron to get the octet configuration, or it will lose the electron. If it accept the extra electron into this orbital, it will get minus one oxidation state. If it loses this electron, plus one oxidation state. Okay, so this is first thing. Suppose if the electron is excited to the next energy level, I'm writing like this: NS, NP. And I'm writing ND. Say this is your NS orbital, NP orbital, ND orbital. Okay. If one of these P orbital electron jumps into the next level, okay, then what happens? Earlier here 2 electrons, now only 1 electron. So that 1 electron comes here into the ND orbital. So now if you see here, how many unpaired electrons are there? 1, 2, 3. So here we have 3 unpaired electrons. So due to these 3 unpaired electrons, it will show plus 3 oxidation state. Here it will show plus 1 and minus 1. Here it is plus 3. That means one electron is excited. So it is happening in its first excited state. First excited state. Next one, if the electron moves into the another electron, if it is moving into the next d orbital. Suppose if this electron is going, jumping into the next orbital like this. So here how many electrons will left? Only one electron. Now total number of unpaired electrons are how many now? There are 5 unpaired electrons. There are 5 unpaired electrons. So due to these 5 unpaired electrons, it will show plus 5 oxidation state. So you have This is happening in which oxidative, which excited state? Second excited state, isn't it? Second excited state. If this electron will also jump, that is in third excited state. Okay, in third excited state, what happened, guys? This ns electron will also jump into the 3d orbital. So here, one electron, one here. Why fluorine does not show plus one oxidation state? Fluorine is the highest electronegative element, so it will not show. And why it will not show plus three oxidation state? To jump an electron, you need a vacant d orbital, because fluorine is in second period. There is no d orbital available. So that's what chlorine, bromine, iodine only shows this higher oxidation state, plus 3, plus 5, plus 7. Because the electron jumping possibility is there because they are of higher periodic elements. So here, how many unpaired electrons? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. There are 7 unpaired electrons are present in this. So due to that, it will show plus 7 oxidation state. Is that clear to you guys? Okay. Next concept. So here in the fluorine, what I just explained is, so here due to the absence of d orbital, fluorine cannot extend it octet. So it exhibits only minus one oxidation state. So shall I write the point here? In fluorine, due to the absence of d orbital, it cannot expand its octet. Okay, so it exhibits only plus one oxidation state only. So it exhibits a plus one oxidation state only. Okay. And these halogens all are strong oxidizing agents. Okay. In the next page, I'll write chemical property after oxidation state. So second one I'm writing. Here, these all halogens. Halogens are strong oxidizing agent. Halogens are strongest oxidizing agents in the all available oxidation reagents in the periodic table. So here I'll write a point. Here halogens, important point is, one halogen oxidizes halide ions of higher atomic number. So what is the meaning of this? Let's start with the, suppose, fluorine. Fluorine can oxidize, it's all below group halide ions to their halogens. Suppose, if you take fluorine, its below element is what? Chloride is converted into chlorine. Bromide is converted into bromine. Iodide is converted into iodine. This is about fluorine. Here fluorine is acting as oxidizing agent, because here minus one oxidation state is changed to zero. So fluorine can oxidize all below halide ions. It's below fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine. Okay. Next, if you take bromine can oxidize, it's below all halide ions. After bromine, what do you have? Chlorine. Sorry, I have to write here chlorine. So after fluorine, you have chlorine, right? So chlorine can oxidize, it's below halides. Bromide is converted into bromine. Then iodide is converted into iodide. Next, bromine, if you take, bromine can iodize, it's below iodide. So iodide is converted into iodine. Okay, that means fluorine can oxidize all its lower halides. Chlorine, lower halides. Bromine, lower halide is only iodine. So this is how it happens. Okay. So if you write a balanced equation of any of these, you can take. Suppose I am taking fluorine. Fluorine on reaction with any of this halogen. Suppose chloride I am taking. It is converting into chlorine and fluoride. Fluorine is acting as oxidizing agent. Oxidizing agent. So it oxidizes the other one. So minus one charge is converting into zero, and itself it undergoes reduction, right? Look at this. Here zero oxidation state, but converted to minus one. And here minus one is converted into zero. So here two chlorides if it. So this is a balanced equation. Okay. So here halide ion is converted into halogen. Minus one is to zero. So it is oxidized. Chlorine minus one is converted into chlorine zero. It is oxidized. Okay. So this is how you have to balance the equation of halogens. Next, we'll talk about reaction with the water. Reaction with the water. Here, fluorine is such a strong oxidizing agent. It convert water to oxygen. So first case, I am talking about the fluorine. Fluorine converts water. You have taken water. Water is converted to oxygen gas. So that's what it is, a strong oxidizing agent. So here, what has happened? Water is converted to oxygen gas. So in water, what is oxidation state of oxygen? Minus two. Here it is zero. Oxidation happened or not? Yes, minus two is converting into zero. So it is an oxidation process. Here, chlorine and bromine, these two reactions are important, guys. Chlorine on reaction with it water, it will convert it into two different types of acids. Very, very important reaction. Reaction with water is important always. Okay. Chlorine on reaction with water, it forms two different types of acid. Simple hydrochloric acid. Okay. And hypochlorous acid. What is the name of this? This you know, right? This is called hypochlorous acid. Here, hypohalous, HOX type. Wherever HOX comes, you have to, okay, name it as hypohalous acid. Here, in the place of halogen, you have chlorine. So, hypochlorous acid. If it is bromine, hypobromous acid. Okay, so third one we'll do about bromine only. Bromine on reaction with water converting into HBr and HOBr. So what is the name of this? Hypobromous acid. Okay. Next. Compared to fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine is a weak oxidizing agent. That's what, when it reacts with water, see what is happening. H plus on reaction with this, okay, oxygen, iodide is converting into iodine. That means what is oxidized? Minus one is converted into zero. Iodine is only undergone oxidation. So in the presence of oxygen or water molecule, due to the presence of oxygen is more electronegative. Okay. and its reaction is more. That's what here. This also, this oxygen acts as oxidizing agent, not iodine. So here, so what happens now? If you observe first and second equation, they are exactly opposite. In the place of fluorine, you have iodine. That's it. They are exactly opposite. Here, fluorine is acting as oxidizing agent, so water is converted into oxygen. But in this case, here oxygen is acted as oxidizing agent, so oxygen is converted to water, and iodide is converted to iodine. Here, fluorine is converted to fluoride. So here, oxygen is acting as oxidizing agent. So very important reactions to these four. Reaction with water, please. Important. This is stress more on it. Okay, guys. Next, we'll move to another concept. That is anomalous behavior of fluorine. Fluorine is having some different properties. Okay. So I'm writing here. Shall I write here? Okay. Why fluorine behaves abnormally? So very simple. The reasons were known to you. Why it is behaving differently? Reason is due to small size. Okay. Why it is behaving differently? Due to small size, highest, and it is having highest electronegativity, and it is also having low FF bond dissociation, isn't it? Just now we have discussed. It is having low bond dissociation energy. And other thing, and there is absence of d orbital. Absence of d orbital. Okay. So that's what it behaves abnormal. So the special characters this fluorine is having, no other element is having these characters in seventh group element, isn't it? The other group elements have little bigger sizes and low electronegativity. Their bond dissociation energy is also high, and they have d orbitals. But they're completely opposite of fluorine. So that's what this fluorine behaves differently. Okay. So next we'll move to chemical properties of fluorine, all halogens. Next, reaction with hydrogen. How they will react with hydrogen? Suppose hydrogen gas on reaction with any halogen, it will form acids. Suppose hydrogen on reaction with fluorine, what it will form? HF, hydrofluoric acid. So they form acids. What they will form? They form acids. Fluoric acid, chloro, okay, hydrofluoric acid, chloro acid, bromo, iodo, all type of acids are forming in this. So suppose if all types of acids are formed, like HF, HCl, HBr, HA. Okay. So what is their bond strength or bond enthalpy? Bond enthalpy. From left to right, if you are moving, what happens? Hydrogen is constant, but the halogen size is increases. So what is happening from left to right as you are moving? Halogen X size increases. So as the size increases, what happens? This hydrogen halogen bond length increases, isn't it? As the bond length increases, HX bond energy decreases. So bond enthalpy or bond energy is decreases. So which one will have stronger bond enthalpy? HF. Least will be HI, because halogen size is big, iodine size is big, So the bond length from hydrogen to iodine nucleus is also higher. So bond dissociation energy is less. So bond enthalpy is this. That means which one will give ready proton to break this molecule HF. Suppose I am taking HF to HI. If you break this, you will get H plus ion. If you break this, you will get H plus ion. So for breaking which bond, more energy is required? This. More energy is required. That means with a small amount of energy, this HI readily produces. H plus readily produced in this case. Because what is the reason? Bond dissociation energy is less for HI. So which one will act as more acid? Which one will act as a stronger acid in this? The one which readily gives protons will act as a strong acid. So if bond dissociation energy is like this, then acidic strength will be reverse of this, right? So which one will act as a stronger acid? Now I am talking about acidic strength of this. So HF, HCl, HBr, HI. Are you listening, guys? So if to break this bond is more energy is required, then it is less energy is required. So from this hydrogen H plus will readily comes out. So that becomes more acidic. Okay. So this is the acidic strength of these acids. Next. This is also important. So most of the students, they get confused that HF, because more electronegativity, this will be the more acidic. That's wrong. Okay. So based on bond energy orders, we have to give this answer. Okay. HF is not strong acid when compared to HI. HI is only very strong acid. Hope you understood the reasons. Next, reaction with the oxygen. Reaction with the oxygen. So what happens when they react with the oxygen? So normally, if you take a fluorine on reaction with oxygen, it will form two types of oxides, OF2 and O2F2. In this only the case, oxygen generally, it will not show negative oxidation state. It will not show positive oxidation state, but it will show positive oxidation state only in combination with fluorine. What is the reason? Because fluorine electronegativity is greater than oxygen. That's what oxygen is forced to take positive charge when it is in combination with fluorine. So here oxygen will take, okay. So here O2F2 is the reason. Next. And thermally, these two are formed when react with oxygen, but thermally more stable is this one. Thermally more stable oxide. Okay. Normal at room temperature 298 Kelvin, it is more stable. So in these two oxide forms, OF2 is more stable. And these two are oxidizing agents because they are highly electronegative. They can oxidize anything. Okay. So these two, both are oxidizing agents. Both of them are oxidizing agents. So here bond enthalpy order, acidic strength is most important in this case. Okay. Next. Here, one another important property of O2F2. This O2F2 is reacts with plutonium and it will form plutonium hexafluoride, PU, plutonium means. It is mainly used in nuclear reactors. Okay. So this mainly used in nuclear reactors. Two. It is used in this OTF2 mainly used in, okay, used in nuclear reactors to remove, okay, plutonium. See, this plutonium is converting into to remove plutonium as plutonium hexafluoride from used to nuclear fuels. So normally nuclear fuels, we will use nuclear fuels as uranium 92 235 and uranium 92 238. These were frequently used to nuclear fuels. These uranium isotopes, after using, they will converting into plutonium. So this plutonium has to remove from the nuclear reactors now. So that's what your O2F2 is utilizing here. Have you understood? So normally in nuclear reactors, fuels are used as uranium 92, 235 and 238 isotopes. These isotopes, when utilized for the production of power, okay, they will convert into plutonium. So this is a byproduct. It shouldn't be there in the nuclear reactors. So this is removed by using O2F2 reaction. It will converting into plutonium hexafluoride, then it will be thrown outside of the nuclear reactors by using this O2F2 oxide, fluorine oxide. Okay. Next one. This is about to fluorine oxides. Next we'll talk about chlorine oxides. So chlorine oxides like Cl2O, ClO2, Cl2O6, Cl2O7. Here, this some properties of Cl2O. It is used as bleaching agent. Used as bleaching agent. Are you listening, guys? Used as bleaching agent for paper pulp and textile. In textile industry also it is used, and it is also used in water treatment. So it is used in bleaching agent. That means colored compound becomes colorless. So some color papers, if you add chlorine oxide, so that color becomes changes, colorless, white it becomes. And in textile industry, some change, dyeing purpose also they will use it. I mean, colored compound is converted into colorless. In water treatment also, Cl2O is used. Cl2O7, it is thermodynamically more stable chlorine oxide. Okay, thermodynamically more stable chlorine oxide is Cl2O7. Okay, so if you talk about its structure, Cl2O7, look at this. Each chlorine is in tetrahedral geometry. Look at this. This is a tetrahedral geometry. Can you see this? Tetrahedral geometry. This chlorine is also having tetrahedral geometry. So here, each chlorine is in which hybridization? 3 plus 1, 4. So sp3. Tetrahedral geometry. Okay. Chlorine is in which hybridization, guys? SP3 tetrahedral geometry. Is it clear? Next. If you move to next one, after chlorine, I'll move to bromine oxides. So bromine oxides like Br2O, BrO2, okay, BrO3 or well known. They are very powerful oxidizing agents. As you are going down the group, their oxidation stability, oxidizing capacity decreases, because as the size of the halogens increases, they can easily diffuse, they can easily dissociate. So oxygen donation becomes easier for them as you are going down the group from fluorine to iodine. Their oxidation power increases. So they will act as very powerful oxidizing agents. Okay. They are powerful oxidizing agents. This bromine oxides, they are least stable oxides of halogens. They only least stable compared to iodides also. The reason it will come, I'll explain you. So if you talk about stability of oxides of halogens, so this is important point. Stability of oxides of halogen, okay, oxides of halogen stability I'm talking about. So here, anyway, fluorine rarely forms oxides, like only two compounds, O2F2 and OF2. So if you neglect that, iodide oxides are more stable, iodine oxides, then chlorine oxides, then bromine oxides. So this is really important, guys. Keep that in box. So if you talk about oxides, iodine oxides are more stable than chlorine oxides, then bromine oxides. It is explained based on Poisson's rule. Okay, what is Poisson's rule, guys? Poisson's rule. Suppose simply says more stable cation, and so here. I'm talking about iodine oxides. Suppose iodine is a large size anion, and oxygen, suppose you are having more number of oxygens like O2 minus. So this larger size anion, I'll take it as suppose I'll take a compound. I will start like this. I2O4. So in this, large size cation and large size anions, both are present, right? So large size cation and large size anions are get maximum stability. So what is the point here? Large size cation. Okay, one thing you will do, it is not based on Poisson's. Poisson's talks about covalent bond. Sorry for this. Okay, large size cation. Here, this is a rule. Large size cation is stabilized by large size anions. That is a point. Okay. So here, large size cations are stabilized by large size anions. So iodine is a large size oxygen. Okay. Comparatively, because four oxygens, they become large. So more stability. Next, I'll talk about iodine oxides. Some examples of iodine oxides. They are the stable oxides of halogens. Okay. Examples like I2O4, I2O5, I2O7. I2O4. What is this? I2O4, I2O5, I2O7. So here, I'll give you some important point here. One second. Here, preparation of I2O5 is important. Preparation of I2O5, I'm giving. 2 moles of iodate, HiO3, when heated it to 240 degrees centigrade, it will give you I2O5 and hydrogen gas expulsion. Hydrogen gas expulsion. So these things are enough here. Next, they are ionizable solids. Iodine is a solid, right? So these oxides are also solids only. They are easily ionizable. They are ionizable solid. They decompose on heating. They decompose on heating. Here, I2O5, this alone is a good oxidizing agent. I2O5 is a good oxidizing agent. And another important point of this, it is used in estimation of carbon monoxide. Estimation of carbon monoxide, CO. Estimation of carbon monoxide. Next one. Another chemical properties we'll discuss. This is about oxides. So iodine oxides are more stable than chlorine, than bromine. In that, I2O5 is important. Its chemical property also we have seen. Next. We'll talk about reaction with the metals. Next one is reaction with the metals. So how they react with the metals, let's see. So suppose any metal M you can take on reaction with this halogens X2, it will form, okay? If it is a first group element, it will form MX type, or second group MX2 type. One example I'll take. Suppose sodium, it is a first group element on reaction with the chlorine gas, suppose. How it will convert, guys? 2 moles of sodium chloride. So it is MX type. Suppose second group element, if you take magnesium, how it will convert? Magnesium chloride. So MX2 type. So this is with the first group elements. This is with the second group elements. Okay. So if it reacts, it will form MX type. Second group, MX2 type. Okay. So in this first group, suppose all of them are first group are forming. Suppose first A group or anything you can take, MX type, all MX type I am taking. So their ionic character, how it changes. So ionic character decreasing order. So that means metal fluorides are forming, metal chlorides are forming, metal bromides are also forming, metal iodides are also forming. All are forming. In this case, which is more ionic? Okay. The ionic character is more in fluorides, then chloride, then bromide and iodide. So this is ionic character order. Another important point. Okay. There decreases from top to bottom ionic character. Next one. Reaction with the hydrocarbons. What is mean by a hydrocarbon carbon hydrogen combination compounds? Suppose methane on reaction with the fluorine, what happens? So all the hydrogens are replaced by fluorine, so it becomes CF4 and H2. This is a rapid reaction because fluorine is highly reactive in nature. Suppose if methane on reaction with chlorine in the presence of sunlight. So what type of reaction takes place? Free radical substitution type of reaction takes place, guys. They involve in free radical substitution reaction. So in the first step, one proton is replaced by chlorine. So CH3Cl and HCl. Next step, if you take this CH3Cl again on reaction with chlorine gas, same conditions, you will get CH2Cl2 plus HCl. The product in the second step, take here CH2Cl2 again on reaction with chlorine with the same conditions, sunlight, H nu, and free radical substitution reaction till converting into CHCl3 plus. So in each reaction, one hydrogen is removing and chlorine is adding. Is that clear? CHCl3 on reaction with chlorine, you will get CCl4 and HCl. What is the name of this? Chloromethane, dichloromethane, or chloroform or trichloromethane, carbon tetrachloride. So like this, a step-by-step reaction takes place. On reaction with hydrocarbons, on reaction with chlorine. Suppose chlorine is also, this halogens is also used in addition reactions, reaction with alkenes. Suppose CH2 double bond CH2 is there. If a chlorine is added, what will happen? Here one chlorine will add and double bond become single bond like this. Suppose chlorine we are taking, right? Like this. Okay. Suppose if you take a benzene ring, halogenation reactions, this you might studied in haloalkanes, haloarenes chapter. On reaction with chlorine in the presence of this catalyst FeCl3, what you are going to get? Chlorobenzene you are going to get. So this is on reaction with the hydrocarbons. Next, this the points I am going to discuss now are very, very important. Many times appeared in the exam. This is reaction with alkalis. What is this? Reaction with alkalis. What is mean by reaction with alkalis? Reaction with alkalis means your basic compounds, sodium hydroxide, suppose. Here, due to the different abnormal behavior, fluorine is having different chemical reactions when compared to other halogens. Okay, so very, very important. First one, reaction with the fluorine, this alkalines. Fluorine on reaction with sodium hydroxide, but which is cold and dilute. Cold and dilute, not highly concentrated, and low temperatures are used. That's what it is called. In this case, the products are very important. Sodium fluoride, OF2, and water are the products obtained. So just balance this equation. 2F2, 2NaOH, and okay, now it's balanced. So this underlining product you just observe. Next, same fluorine on reaction with sodium hydroxide, but in the second case I'm using it is hot and concentrated. In that case, okay, NaF is common, but instead of OF2 you will get O2 and 2 moles of water. Okay, so here sodium fluoride is common in both the cases, but instead of OF2 here oxygen is releasing. So very, very important reactions. Okay, previous questions, these are all okay. Then reaction with fluorine. Next, second reaction with other halogens, any halogen you can take. Suppose I am taking, mostly they confine to fluorine or chlorine, they don't go up to bromine and iodine. So here I'll take on reaction with chlorine, chlorine on reaction with sodium hydroxide. So what is the first case? Cold and dilute you can take. Cold and dilute. In that case, what are the products are forming? Sodium chloride and NaOCl and H2. Okay, so balance this equation. Okay, what is the name of this? If it is HOCl, what is that? HOCl, hypochlorous acid. Here, sodium hypochlorous acid. What is the name of this? Sodium hypochlorous acid. Sodium hypochlorous acid. Next one, the same chlorine, if it reacts with hot and concentrated sodium hydroxide, what happens? I'm using hot and concentrated. In that case, sodium chloride is common. NaClO3 is a product and H2O. Just balance this. Okay, so here NaClO3, its name is sodium chlorate. This is most important area from today's class. Okay, so you need to be very careful. So many times appeared in the exam. Okay, so here look at this. When fluorine it reacts, okay, what is happening? Oxygen containing compounds like OF2 and O2 is coming, NaF is common. If it is chlorine, NaCl is common. Look at this, fluorine means NaF because sodium we are using. Sodium chloride and sodium fluorides are common. The only difference is, again, water is also common in all the cases. The only difference is these oxidized products. So in the cold and dilute, OF2, hot and concentrated, O2. That's the only thing you have to be answered. Next, on reaction with chlorine, it a hypochlorous in the first one, and in the concentrated and hot, sodium chlorate, NaClO3. So this is very, very important, guys. Please practice this. Okay, practice with the balanced equation, this one especially. Okay. With this, I'll stop today's session. Chalo guys, tomorrow we'll come up with a few other chemical properties of halogens. Okay, I'm signing off. Thank you all of you. You can leave now. Okay guys, good night all of you. Okay, have you noted down this? Anyway, I'm going to post these notes in our group. So don't bother. Hello, I'm signing off. Thank you all of you. Good night.